Our sinful natures are constantly trying to drag us out of the worshipful experience, and so you have to be engaged now. There's going to be some guy up there talking for a while, and you're going to be tempted to let your mind wander, to be thinking of other things, to be distracted from God's message to you. I'm usually distracted by, I wonder what the Greek word is under there, and I'm tempted to get out my phone and look it up. It's like, no. God is speaking to me. Listen to the message. So don't be distracted. And for his help, let us begin with prayer. Lord God, we are grateful for your word. We're grateful that you have not gone silent, but continue to speak to us in your word. And we pray, Lord, that your spirit would be at work, giving us soft hearts that are willing and eager to receive your word planted, that it would grow to bear much fruit in our lives. We desire to be made more like Christ. We desire for you to be at work in us. And so, Lord, use this time and this message to do that so that we will be able to better glorify you with our lives. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. This is a fourth message in a series called The Purpose of Life. When we look at the shorter catechism, question number one, the question is, what is the chief end of man? Meaning, what is the point? What is this all about? What is the chief end? What is the main focus? And the answer is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. That's our purpose, to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. And so when we look in Scripture, what does that look like? Where do we see glorifying God? Where do we see enjoying Him in Scripture? And so that's what the intent of this series is, to bring that out to light. And so the first week we looked at how we're made in the image of God. That in itself is a glorious thing. We are the pinnacle of creation, and as His image bearers, we have been given the charge to have dominion over the earth, over everything on the earth, and to reflect His image throughout our lives and everything that we do, the way we live. And the second week, we looked at worship, the primacy of worship, and how in our worship we glorify God, and also are praising Him because of all of His wonderful things that we're enjoying Him as well, right? So in our worship, which is not just intended to be only on, the Lord's Day, but throughout the week. And the third message, we looked at how our purpose and the way we glorify God is to love one another. In our love, which is the greatest and the basis of all of the fruit of the Spirit, our loving of one another glorifies God. And we enjoy that and enjoy Him, not only in our loving of others, but as they love us. And so this week, we come to the fourth, and the purpose that we have in life is to glorify God and enjoy Him as we are witnesses to Him, to the gospel, to all of the things that He has done. And as we do that, we glorify Him, we lift Him up, and it's a reflection of praise and a joy that we have in recognizing all that He has done and has promised to do for us. We have this tendency to think that the witnesses, those who are witnesses, those who share the gospel, those are the missionaries. And is it only the missionaries who are supposed to be doing that? No, we all have the responsibility to share the gospel and to be witnesses of His grace and the ways that He works in our lives to others, to bring Him glory in that way. Matthew 10 says, "Everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. And whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father." And the context of that verse is persecution. So even in persecution, we are to be witnesses to God, to the world, about God, the gospel, what He has done, what is true about Him. And God gets the glory in the midst of our persecution to be pointing to Him. And, you know, I think about Paul when he was imprisoned and in chains. And what is he doing? He's singing in the jail. He's singing praises. And all of the other prisoners are listening to this guy who is in jail being persecuted for his faith. And yet he is singing praises to God, being a witness. And what glory does God get from that? And God uses it to bring others to faith. Sometimes we hear that this work of being a witness is a work that only happens in this life. When we get to the next life, we're not going to be witnessing anymore. But what they mean by that is evangelism, right? Evangelism is one of the ways that we witness, right? When we're sharing the gospel. That part, you know, we're not going to be sharing the gospel in heaven. Because, you know, those people already know the gospel, right? So they've already been saved. They don't need the gospel, but, you know, there's still great joy and glory, God-given glory, you know, in that will be praised forever, right? In Ephesians 1, it says, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance, until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory, right? So even just our salvation, of course, praise to his glory, and that will never end. For all of eternity, we will be thinking about how gracious God is to have saved us, sinners, so undeserving of it, and to have been blessed by it. We will praise him forever because of that. We will also be praising him for all of his other works and good deeds. In Psalm 105, it says, sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice forever and ever and ever. We will never cease to be witnesses to the glory of God because of all of his great works that he has done to us personally, to the church at large, and in the world. So this is one of our purposes, one of the things that we are called to do, to be a witness to what God has done, and especially his glory. One of the things I have taught before is about how we should always turn any glory we get back to God, right? And this is one of the ways that we do this as a witness. You know, Heath, you did such a great job on that project. It's amazing. I can't believe you did all that. I have the opportunity at work to say, well, I was able to do that because God enabled me to. All the glory that I'm getting directed right back to the Lord. And that's a way that we witness in the world to the glory of God. We can't do anything apart from God. All I'm doing is speaking that truth into the world, and God can use it however he wishes to, but he gets the glory, and I get the joy knowing that he's using me, and I'm relying on him, right? There are many, many ways that we can be witnesses, and I don't have time to cover all of those. I'm going to focus instead today on specifically evangelism, because that is something that is important for us, each one of us, to do in this life that we won't be doing in eternity. Evangelism. And so as we think about evangelism, you know, how do I go about teaching evangelism and how to do it? Well, first we have to know the gospel. The gospel is the message that is getting, that we need to get across to the unconverted, right? What is the gospel? And often, you may be asked, what is the gospel? What is the gospel? Because Bob will ask you, you know, somebody else will come. Well, tell me the gospel. You know, puts you on a spot, quizzes you. And sometimes when I'm getting around there, somebody I think who should know it is like, you know, deer with the headlights, you know. It's like, I don't know. And it's a hard question. So I'm going to tell you, what is the gospel? Next time someone asks you, what is the gospel? This is the gospel. Three things, three main parts to the gospel message, all right? The first is man in misery. The second is God in grace. And the third is faith and future. Okay, if you can remember those three things, you've got the gospel. All right, the first one, man in misery, is about how we are fallen, sinful creatures and destined for judgment. Okay, that's point one. Ephesians 2, 1 through 3 brings that out fairly well. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world. We all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. So you see in there the sinfulness that we have in our hearts that is dragging us down. And can you imagine what the world would be like if there was no influence of God and the law and the Spirit? Well, that's what they had before the flood. Every thought continually of man was evil. And so God judged the world, right? And that is an image and a picture of the judgment that is to come in the future. Because we are sinful people in need of a Savior. So that's the first thing, man in misery. The second is God and grace. God has made a way of salvation through Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. And because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, those who deserve judgment can be saved. That's the second part, okay? And John 3:16, pretty good summary of that. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Jesus Christ is the focus, and the grace that comes to the fallen person and all that's required is faith. And that's the third part. Three. Faith and future, okay? The faith is all that is required for us to put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And then we have the future to look forward to, the future of eternal life, the future inheritance that is being preserved for us. Ephesians 1, 13 and 14 summarizes that. When you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, that's the faith, we're sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance. We have an inheritance that we look forward to with joy. And even in this life, we have been blessed by the Holy Spirit, which is transforming our lives and causing us to live more like Christ and to enjoy his blessings. Okay? This is the gospel. What is the gospel? Man in misery, God in grace, faith and future. If you can remember that, then you'll be able to answer simply, what is the gospel? Now, there are a lot of other ways that you can do that. You know, there's nothing magical or about this way. We've also taught in our church, God, man, Christ, you, which is, they're all the same principles, okay? God, he is sovereign, creator. He owns you. He demands perfect righteousness, and he has given us a law. Man, we have broken the law. We deserve judgment, and we are without hope. Christ is the answer. He brings the offer of salvation from the judgment that we deserve. And we need to put our faith and trust in him so that our sins will be forgiven and we can have that salvation. And then the you is just a reminder to put it on them now. What are you going to do with this information? What decision are you going to make? Are you going to put your faith in Jesus Christ today, right? So that's another good one. God, man, Christ, you. Many use the Romans road, and I put those verses on the handout there, and you just go through Romans, and you read these verses, and you talk about each of the verses, and they're all the same things. Man in misery, God in grace, faith in future, okay? And there's involved programs you can get into to learn how to share the gospel, Way of the Master, Evangelism Explosion, and others. And those are, you know, some of those are good. Not all of them are good. Some of them leave out very important things. But that's just understanding what the gospel is, okay? And we should all understand the gospel if we're believers, right? What are you a believer in? You kind of have to know the gospel. So the next thing then, if we're going to be witnesses to the gospel, well, how do we get up the nerve There's a lot of fear that we have in sharing the gospel. Fear of rejection, fear of persecution, fear that we'll mess things up. We'll say the wrong thing and they'll be lost forever and it's my fault. You know, there's a lot of fear and anxiety that hinders us. And so where do we begin? The first step is prayer. Prayer is absolutely essential. We are just little talking mouths, okay? The Holy Spirit is doing the real work, okay? When we come and are a witness to the gospel, we are just speaking words. And hopefully those words are in alignment with Scripture, which is the Holy Spirit's word, right? We are speaking the gospel, but the Holy Spirit is the one that's doing the work, okay? The Holy Spirit is the one that's softening the heart so they can hear. The Holy Spirit is the one who is making the words make sense in their mind. The Holy Spirit is the one who's doing the real work. We're just speaking words. And I've heard so many stories about people who've been saved by the dumbest things. Just a single verse from Scripture that they heard that is like totally out of context and has nothing to do with anything, and the Holy Spirit uses that to bring them to a conviction of sin and an understanding that they need a Savior. We are just little talking mouths, okay? The trick is to get to the point where we are talking mouths, okay? If we keep our mouths shut, we're not being a witness. We've got to get to the point where we can open our mouths so we can be talking mouths so that the Holy Spirit can use what we're saying to bring conviction of sin and bring people out of darkness into light. So, what do we pray for? First, we pray for opportunity. Colossians 4. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word. Okay? We're praying constantly for an opportunity to be a talking mouth. Okay. Second, we're praying for receptive hearts. 2 Thessalonians 3, pray for us that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored. Okay, we're praying that even before we go to speak to someone, that the word is going forward. It's speeding ahead. The hearts are being prepared. The Holy Spirit is at work on those who are going to hear before we even get there, and that the word will be honored when it is spoken. Okay, so we pray for receptive hearts. And third, boldness. This is when we go from knowing what we should do to actually being a talking mouth. Okay? We're going to pray for boldness. And this is Paul in this verse in Ephesians 6. Paul is asking for prayer for all the saints, but also for him, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly. You know, we think about Paul being like, you know, he's the master evangelist, but he is asking for prayer that he will not keep his mouth closed, that he will be able to open his mouth boldly. And so we have to also be in prayer for that. If you are serious about being a witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ, you need to be praying for all three of these every day. This is essential. We begin with prayer because who's doing the work? The Holy Spirit is doing the work. We've got to be in prayer asking for the Holy Spirit to be at work, asking that he use us as a partner in being a talking mouth to bring the Holy Spirit's word to his elect so that they can hear and repent and turn. Okay, so we've prayed. How do we know what to say? Okay, well, you have to know the gospel, right? We went through the gospel. There's different ways of presenting, understanding the gospel. The same key points all the time, though, right? Man in misery, God in grace, faith in future. The same points, however you want to do it. You can memorize scripture, but you've got to have some kind of plan. And this is the preparation part, okay? You have to be prepared, as Peter says in 1 Peter 3. Honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the hope that is in you, right? So we have to be prepared. We're definitely relying upon the Holy Spirit. Most of this is just for us to have that boldness to be the talking mouth, okay? We need to get to a point where we are comfortable enough to actually be willing to open our mouth, okay? So we've got to prepare. We've got to have something ready to say. okay? And if you like the Romans Road, great. Memorize those verses even, so you don't even have to turn through them and read them in the Bible. You know, whatever it is to get the points across, you be prepared. Come up with something that is comfortable to you that you like, okay? And know it and be ready. And you're praying every day for opportunity, for softened hearts, for boldness, okay? The Lord will give you an opportunity to open your mouth and be that talking mouth, right? I'm going to be in 1 Corinthians 2 for a little bit, so if you want to turn to 1 Corinthians 2, it's on the handout as well. If you don't want to turn there, that's fine. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Some other things. Now, in this section, there's a lot of background I could give you. The short nutshell version is that people have come in behind Paul and are trying to build themselves up to be better than Paul. And Paul is saying, you know, that's fine. They can be all built up and everything. I'm just a little talking mouth, okay? And God is doing all the work. And so let's see what Paul has to say here about sharing the gospel. 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 and 2 first. And notice what he's saying is, I'm not like those guys. I'm just plain and simple. And I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Okay? That's the message. It's simple. You don't have to spend 45 minutes presenting. And I'm ashamed to say the first time I shared the gospel, I probably spent 45 minutes. I was sharing the gospel with a friend from high school, and his eyes glazed over after 5 minutes, and I was talking about Adam and Eve and the fall, and then I was talking about the Exodus from Egypt and how it was a picture of what was happening with Christ, and way overload. Plain and simple. And Paul says here, I'm focusing only on Jesus Christ and him crucified. Hone in on that. That's the second point. God and grace, right? You got to talk about the man of misery, but the focus is on God and grace, all right? And then he hit the faith and future. Plain and simple. All right, now in verses 3 and 4, notice how Paul is not relying on himself. He downplays himself because the Holy Spirit is the one that's at work. He's downplaying himself in 3 and 4. And as I was with you in weakness... And remember, this is Paul, the great evangelist, describing himself in sharing the being a witness to the gospel. Weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom. You know, this is how Paul is describing his talent. He is just a talking mouth, you know? It doesn't have to make sense. And in fact, it's impossible to believe. Do you believe Jesus died and was raised from the dead? That is not very plausible, right? It's impossible to believe apart from the Holy Spirit. This whole thing is ridiculous. The sharing of the gospel and people believing it and coming to faith, a man was raised from the dead. The Holy Spirit is the one who's doing the work. Well, here's just a little talking mouse, okay? And that's what Paul is saying here. I am weak. I was in fear, much trembling. My speech, message were not plausible words of wisdom. Okay, does that describe anyone in here when you're thinking about sharing the gospel? Paul was right there as well. And then verse 5. So that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. It's the Holy Spirit who's doing it. The Holy Spirit has the power, not you, not your words. Not anything about you, right? He has just called us to be ministers of his word. He has called us to speak the gospel, to speak the words of life, and the Holy Spirit takes them and the Holy Spirit does what he's going to do. And even if you do it badly, the Holy Spirit is going to use it for his glory. Okay? I have heard so many stories about it done badly, but somebody famous turns, you know, follows Christ. Moving on. All right, so how do we know what to say? We got to be prepared and we've got to keep it simple. Okay, we've got to not rely on us. Okay, it's not how smart we are, how well we present. It's none of that. It's just us being willing to be a talking mouth. Okay, so we need that boldness, and we need a comfort level within ourselves so that we can get there. Okay, so be prepared enough just to be willing to open your mouth. And then we rely on the Spirit and the Spirit's power to do the work. Okay, it's just like Bob has taught us many times about our prayers, right? The Spirit changes our prayers, with groanings that we can't speak. You know, we may be asking the wrong things in prayer. The Holy Spirit asks the right things for us. And the same exact thing is happening here when we are witnessing. We are the talking mouth, sputtering stuff that, even if it's understood perfectly, is nonsense, that a man was raised from the dead. And the Holy Spirit is taking that and using it to do a work in that person's heart. Or not. We don't know if they're of the elect, right? Our job is not to know. Our job is to do. Okay, and this is very important too. The other thing you should do is have a personal testimony. Okay, it's one thing to be talking about all this theological stuff and man and sin and grace and the blood of Christ and cleansing from sin and faith and all, but so what? You can bring your presentation home with a personal testimony. What has the Lord done in your life personally to make a difference? Okay? Look what Paul's doing in Acts 26:14. He says, and he is telling his conversion testimony to a large group of people. And he says, we had all fallen to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads. Okay, Paul is telling his conversion story, which is Jesus speaking to him audibly. Okay, we're not going to have that kind of, you know, powerful, amazing testimony. You know, Jesus came and spoke to me audibly in Hebrew. You know, but we're going to be more like the demoniac that Jesus healed, and the demoniac wanted to follow Jesus, and Jesus says, no, you're going to be a witness for me. Go back to your home. And in Mark 5:19, it says, go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. It's not complicated. Look at your life. It could be your conversion story. For me, I could tell my conversion story. I was in a depressed place. I didn't know if I believed in God anymore. I was going through a bunch of turmoil and even thinking about suicide. And I needed to decide if I believed there was a God. And I read this verse in John 14, verse 21, which basically says, if you keep my commandments, that shows that you love me, and my Father will love you, and I will love you and manifest myself to you. Oh, wait a minute, that's exactly what I want. I want to know if you're there. If you would manifest yourself to me, that would be fantastic. And so I went all in. I walked down the aisle in the Baptist church I was worshiping in. I made a profession of faith. I was baptized. I didn't fully believe all this, but I was going through the motions. I wanted to keep his commandments to the best of my ability, hoping he would manifest himself to me. And over the next few weeks and months, as I was striving to live according to his word and I was changing my lifestyle, the word began opening up. I began understanding things, and I knew the Spirit was there in me, convicting me of sin. And it was real, okay? This is a personal testimony that you put into your gospel presentation that makes it real. It's not just something floating out there that some Christian people believe. It's real. It affects you. It doesn't have to be conversion. Bob goes back to one breath from death. And that is a very powerful and potent testimony that he can use when he's sharing the gospel to show that it's real. So find something. It doesn't have to be fantastical. It just has to be what the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. Now work that in. Well, that's how to share the gospel. That's how to be a witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, for you advanced people, I have a little bit more. Okay. Maybe you've been doing it for a while, sharing the gospel. Maybe you just like to get it all here at the beginning, and you've never done it before. Well, I'm gonna give you some advanced stuff. All right. How, when you look in Scripture, at how is the gospel shared? And the answer is, it always seems to begin with the law. Why? Why is the law so important in sharing the gospel? And the reason why is because we're hitting that man in misery, right? The first part, man in misery. We've got to talk about the sin and the need for a Savior. If there's no need for a Savior, why is anybody going to listen to Jesus, the Savior? You know, hey, you need to turn your life over and accept Jesus so you can be saved. Saved from what? Right? The law brings home the need for the Savior, as we learn in Romans 3. You know, it says that through the law comes knowledge of sin. Okay, and in Acts 24, Paul is in prison. This is right before he gets sent to Rome, to Caesar. And he's arguing with, or not arguing with, but he's reasoning, as it says in Acts 24, verse 25. He's reasoning with Felix to try and convince him of the gospel. And what is he reasoning about? He's reasoning about righteousness and self-control and judgment. Okay, what is this? This is the man in misery part, okay? Righteousness, you know, God demands righteousness, and how are we? We've got this sinful thing going on in our hearts, and we can't be righteous. Oh, Felix, consider your self-control. Do you have self-control? Can you even do the things you want to do? Well, I have been wanting to lose about 20 pounds, but, well, how's that going for you? Do you have self-control? Why not? Why can't you even do the things you want to do? There's something wrong with your heart. Right? And that's the focus of this part. The man in misery. There's something wrong in the heart. And so he's talking about righteousness and self-control. And because there's something wrong in your heart, judgment. Suddenly, we need a Savior. Okay? Jesus did this all the time. He would bring out the law, but he would go deeper and show how the law was really about a heart thing, right? It wasn't just the externals. Like when he teaches in Matthew 5 about several points of the law, he says, you've heard, you shall not commit adultery, but I say if you have lusted, you have committed adultery. You see, the issue isn't so much the actually going and sleeping with a woman who's not your wife. The issue is that you want to. The issue is that you think about it and you daydream about it. Why? Because there's something wrong in your heart. See, in the law, when we use the law, it brings that out. There's something wrong in there, and maybe I do need a Savior. A man came up to Jesus one time, and his question to Jesus was, how do I inherit eternal life? You know, Jesus didn't say, oh, I'm glad you asked. Just put your faith and trust in me and all of your sins will be forgiven and you will have eternal life. No. Jesus says, well, you know the law. Keep the law. And he goes through several points of the law. And the man, thinking externally, not thinking about his heart, is like, oh, well, I've done all that since I was young. You know, I've been keeping the law. And Jesus senses, I believe, senses that this is a man who's on the verge, right? Because he says in Mark 10, he says, and Jesus loved him, right? The man's genuinely asking because he genuinely knows something is off. I've done all this, but I know it's still not right, okay? And so Jesus cuts right straight into the heart issue with this man. He was wealthy. I mean, obviously, look at his clothes and all the stuff that's going on here. So Jesus says, you lack one thing. Go sell all that you have and give it to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Suddenly the man realizes, I don't want to do that in my heart. There's something in my heart. I don't want to do that. Why? I want eternal life, don't I? I want to follow Jesus, don't I? Or do I want all my stuff more? And he goes away pondering, sorrowful, because he had great possessions. Jesus doesn't run off after him and say, that's okay, now that you understand there's a thing in the heart, put your faith and trust in me. I think that's a good example for us. You know, when we share the gospel, it may be the first time they hear it. And the Lord may have planned that it's not going to happen, that they get it all until the 15th time they've heard it. Okay? It's okay to let them go away and ponder. Let the Holy Spirit work. The Holy Spirit's the one doing it. You're just the talking mouth, right? Let the Holy Spirit do the work. Let the Holy Spirit take the time the Holy Spirit wants to take and bring about as many people as the Holy Spirit wants to bring about to call his people. And the flip side is, maybe he wasn't elect. Maybe the Holy Spirit was not working in his heart. And maybe he was just going off to enjoy his possessions and decide, you know, I'm probably okay. I don't know about that Jesus guy. I've been keeping the law. I've been going to synagogue. I've been giving money to the poor. I'm okay, you know. And maybe he's just lost. We don't know. Our job is just be the talking mouth. Let the Holy Spirit do the work. We are witnesses, okay? But God gets the glory in everything. I have several verses there in point seven about how the heart has to be affected by the Holy Spirit, or it can't receive anything, right? We're totally dependent upon the Holy Spirit. So you can read through those and study those. And in John 3:3, it says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. The Holy Spirit has to be at work to change that heart, to open those blind eyes, to open those stopped up ears, to bring the understanding. Okay. Now there's four possible ways someone can respond to the gospel. And those are in Mark chapter 4. I was going to go through those in some detail, but I'm running out of time here. So very, very briefly, Jesus talks about us as witnesses to the gospel, as being sowers who are tossing seed out. Okay, we're tossing seed into the field. Some of it falls in different places, okay? The seed is the gospel message. It's going out. And the land that the seed falls onto are the people hearing the gospel message, okay? And there's various things, okay? Satan prevents them from hearing, really internalizing the message, okay? Or they appear to understand the gospel, and they're all in on this Christian thing, but as soon as tribulation or persecution comes along, they're like, oh, well, I didn't realize what kind of commitment we were talking about here, and they bail, okay? Or things happen in their life where their true heart is revealed, right? They really do care about their possessions or other things that are going on. They're not willing to make the sacrifices required. They don't love the Lord like they thought they did, and they really still love the world. And then there's the good soil, right? Those are the ones who respond by bearing much fruit, and that's what we're called to do, to bear much fruit. Well, lastly, you know, we are fearful for many reasons to be those talking mouths. And God may bring persecution. The world hates us. The world hates Christ. The world hates being told they're sinners in need of a Savior. And so we may be persecuted. But Jesus says, blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad. When the world hates you, when you're being persecuted, rejoice and be glad. And we see that in Acts several times when the ministers of the gospel are being persecuted and they rejoice. And Peter says in Acts 5 that we are counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. So that's kind of where we're going as witnesses. If we get obnoxious as witnesses, which, you know, might be a good thing in this world, the more obnoxious we are at proclaiming the glory of God, the more quickly we're going to be judged and endure that persecution, which in itself brings glory to God. And we are to rejoice in that and have joyous time. So I encourage you, prepare enough so that you can be confident to open your mouth. Be bold and open your mouth in those situations. Be praying every day. And be willing. And the more you do it, the easier it is. And the less you worry about the world, what the world's going to think about you. And know that the Holy Spirit is the one who's doing the work. You can't mess it up. That's one of the great things about believing in the doctrine of predestination and election. God has chosen his people already. You can't mess it up. He may be using you to bring them into the light. And that's a joyous thing. You can't mess it up. Be the talking mouth. Let the Holy Spirit do the work. Let's pray. Lord God, you are good and faithful and true. And we're thankful for this encouraging message. And we pray that you would cause us to be more faithful in sharing the gospel. More willing to stand up and not be afraid. And we're thankful that no matter what, you are with us to the very end of the age. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.